I'd like to introduce our guest speaker, who is Tamiko Teal. She's a visiting professor right now at UC San Diego.
Yeah.
And so we wanted to take advantage of her being here in California to invite her to come up to LA and speak. Tamiko's American visual artist. She's living in Munich, Germany. A BS in product design engineering from Stanford, an MS in human-machine interface engineering from MIT, and then she went on to get a Master's of Arts in installation art from the Academy of Fine Arts in Munich, which is how she ended up being in Munich, I assume. I think you'll probably go through a few projects today. She was creative director and producer of the award-winning Starbright World Virtual Play Space, which has become a very well-known project founded by Steven Spielberg to help seriously ill children who can't get out into the real world and to give them a kind of virtual world for them to interact in. And it's been very successful. I'm interested in hearing about that. She also will be talking about, I assume, the Manzanar project, which has gotten a lot of attention as a virtual environment dealing with the Japanese internment that happened here in this country. So I'll let you further introduce yourself, and let's welcome Tamiko.
Thanks, and thanks for coming. I guess I want to, this is my website. I think I'm actually running it off the machine right now, but rather than, I'll look quickly. Oh no, this is actually the URL, so it's actually off the internet. Is it possible somehow to douse the lights on the screen, or does that put us in total darkness? Yeah, that's great. So, let's see. How about a show of hands? How many of you actually work with 3D graphics? Okay, maybe about a half. Let's see, what are the other questions that are interesting? How many people know what the term avatars mean, dealing with 3D worlds or MUDs? Okay. How many know the history of the internment? Okay, there's going to be a quiz afterwards, so I hope you're... Okay, so it looks like I've got a fairly savvy crowd here. Whoops, if I don't lose my extra keyboard. So I'm actually going to talk about just two VR projects. And I've been working with VR since 1994. I started actually with the Starbright World project here. And I'd been interested in dealing with 3D graphics even at the point where I was a grad student at MIT. But at that point, you had to program it all yourself. And as I got more and more interested in the artistic end of things rather than the technical end, I decided to wait until it became more feasible. So in 1994, in general, PC-based VR became practicable. And I was hired by one of the first companies that had a working system, Worlds Incorporated, to do the Starbright project. And I thought it was interesting to work in PC-based systems because you know that it's still very, very hard to get pieces, art pieces that are SGI-based or running it on any sort of difficult hardware shown at all. And I like the idea of being able to work with more sort of normal tools and be able to spend more of your time hopefully working on the creative aspects and a little bit less on the technological aspects. So the two pieces that, and the other consideration I had before I wanted to actually start working in virtual reality is I wanted the feeling that I could actually produce some sort of deep content. Some sort of rotating box was not very interesting to me, neither was logos flying around. And then when I was offered this job at Worlds Incorporated doing Starbright World, I thought, okay, this sounds like it's certainly a big chunk of content here. So The Starbite Foundation is a Hollywood-based foundation. Its board of directors is composed of people from entertainment, the Hollywood industries, from high tech, and from the medical field. And the idea is to bring seriously ill children, and these are children with chronic or life-threatening diseases that they will not recover from in their lifetime. AIDS, cystic fibrosis, all the forms of cancer, that sort of very, very, very severe illness. And most of these kids spend a lot of time, as it were, hopping from the home to the hospital and are not able to participate in school life and in regular life of a family because they're often in the hospital. On the other hand, their stays in the hospital is only about 3 days or so. They get the kids out as fast as they can. So, and it's very rare that they ever meet, while they're in the hospital, a kid with exactly the same illness. So these kids lead very socially isolated lives, and they also very rarely know people who have the same, kids that have the same sickness, so they feel like, you know, I'm the only person in the world with cystic fibrosis or so. So the charter of the Starbite Foundation is to use the forms of game technology, entertainment technology, to bring information to these kids in a form that benefits them either in an empowering sense that they learn more about their illness and therefore are better able to at least psychologically deal with it, or to actually distract the kids while they're having painful procedures done. You know, at the very simplest level, if you give a kid some sort of video game while they're getting an intravenous something or other, then they will pay more attention to the game than to the fact that they've got this tube going in their arm. So in 1994 or so, there was someone was donating money to Starbite and said, well, we can build a community center where the kids can come and play with each other, meet each other. Now, the only problem is that the kids can't travel very much. So Steven Spielberg, who's involved in Starbite as the chairman, suggested that, since he was aware of the technology that was being developed in Worlds, and suggested that instead of having a big building in LA where kids could go, they could make an online building where the kids could go, but from their hospital beds. So the idea was to network a bunch of different children's hospitals nationwide together with a private high-speed network and allow the kids from their hospital beds to enter the same space, this one space, and play with each other, communicate with each other there. So Sprint was willing to donate the telephone lines, T3 lines. Intel had their best and fastest Pentium 90 megahertz computers that they were donating to us. And I tell you, this was 1994. They were the best and fastest. Think of that. And Worlds was willing to do the project at cost. And I was hired to first survey the problem, look at the technology, talk with the people at the hospitals, and then propose a solution, and then implement that solution for the kids. So I looked at the MUDs, the multi-user dungeons or domains, where people would, through text chat, be in a virtual space communicating with each other, and the sort of communities that had grown up around this. And maybe a lot of you know about Habitat. It's probably actually called Habitat, isn't it? This is English, after all. Okay, Habitat, Fujita's Habitat, which was was it actually 2D? Yeah. It was actually a 2D visual MUD. Well, so my idea was to make Starbite World a 3D MUD, a space where kids could meet, communicate with each other, play with each other, and then ideally also start building the world, because it seemed like this was the most important part of the technology, the community building aspect of MUDs, was that it wasn't just that people were meeting in one place, but people felt invested because, oh, am I like making it hard for the, I can stay in one place, this is all right, I'll go back here. Okay, where was I? Oh yeah, that the people who formed the community could actually create themselves as avatars, create the places that they lived in, and this invests you in a way that merely going to one place, always a meeting, does not. So looking at the sort of problems that the children suffered from, I wrote this proposal saying, it should be a place where they can reach ideally from any place in their life, from home, from hospital, and they should be able to always meet the same people there so that it shouldn't be restricted to some part of your life. And ideally, they should be able to create their own avatars, design their own personas, and they should be able to build the space themselves. And the technology was basically there. And the technologists in the company said, and what we don't have now, we'll have in 6 months. The 6 months turned out to be more like 3 years, and by then the company had gone bankrupt, but that's another story. But I think you guys are used to doing these sort of technology-driven projects, so you know what sort of problems you're up against. Okay, so let me run down this, see what I've forgotten already. So I had, it varied, but I had at the maximum two programmers and two graphic artists that were creating this world, and we got it into the hospitals very early. They were doing play testing. And I have some videos that are very interesting, but I wanted to show you some stills of the environments that we built. And we had to run at 640 by 480 with a small screen. You can see it's very pixelated, but that was the quality that was available right then. And so we formed a bunch of different, where's my back button? A bunch of different types of worlds, that tropical oasis that you saw, a sky world where, of course, in virtual reality, you know, it's inhibited by things like gravity, so kids could fly around. And in general, try to give them a sense of freedom of movement that they didn't have sitting in these hospital beds or sitting in their own bed at home all the time. And then also maybe some more complicated spaces like the cave world, which had a maze-like structure that they could go in and explore together with friends. Oh, this is Steven Spielberg, by the way, and that's General Schwarzkopf. Those were their avatars. And Steven had a machine set up in his office at Amblin so that he could get online and talk with the kids. And this is the build your own zone, the building world. And probably some of you know of the Active Worlds technology. This was the Active Worlds technology where all of these blocks that you see in the world, you can move around, you can build your own clubhouses, spaces, and we'll see in the video an example of how that was used. So my idealistic concept was that if the kids were allowed to build themselves, build their own avatars, real quick for people who might not be familiar with the term, in a virtual world, the graphic characters, you can't see each other, but you can see these graphic characters that are sometimes animated, sometimes static, and they represent you. Behind each character is someone sitting at a computer somewhere on the network. And you move through these spaces in first-person point of view, as you do in real life, and don't see yourself, but you can see the other people. Again, that might become a bit more clear in the video. So I was thinking, coming to this project as an artist, I was thinking of people like Frida Kahlo, Toulouse-Lautrec, who I knew had spent large amounts of their lifetimes in bed and had used that time to draw and paint and, in general, create a fantasy world and a fantasy life in which they could experience more than they could in real life. And I thought that if we could really build out this tool, then it could be a similar situation for kids, where they could create their own fantasy life, but they could actually inhabit it and they could share it with other people. Not just by saying, hey, look at my nice paintings, but saying, okay, let's meet in my clubhouse. Let's meet in the space that I've created. And for kids that are always moving between the home and the hospital, are always being sort of dislocated, it would be one place where if they could build their own spaces on the network, that would be a continuous part of their life that they could carry with them, as it were. That was the concept. The other part was that it should be non-invasive and non-isolating. A lot of high-end VR deals with either the helmets, where you've got this pair of goggles or a helmet on, and the only thing you can see is the virtual world. And this is a wonderfully immersive sort of experience, but on the other hand, it also cuts you off from your body, it cuts you off from the environment, it cuts you off from the person standing next to you. And it also, if you wear glasses, you know, it's very uncomfortable to have these things pressing on your glasses. And the kids obviously have enough connection with machines in their lives. They got tubes running into their arms and down their noses. They don't need any extra wiring. So the idea was not to have it, oh, and by the way, also, you know, there's this, I forget the exact term, but if the virtual world doesn't move fast enough when you turn, you get a disjunct and it makes people basically motion sick. And the kids on these heavy drugs are sick anyway, and they're also very often very nauseous anyway. So we actually had to really tone down any movement in the space. We had all sorts of wonderful animations of things spinning around. Some of them you'll see in the video. And the nurses said, please, can you slow this down? The kids are getting nauseous looking at your space. It's like, okay. And also non-isolating. Again, these kids have plenty of isolation in their own lives. And they found actually that it was very interesting. The child life specialists, the ones who are responsible for the psychology of the kids, wanted to put the machines in the playrooms. And this means that in order to use them, the kid would actually have to get up out of their bed and walk over to the playroom. And then they would meet other kids. And then they would sit three or more in front of a single machine and talk with each other. So a lot of the very valuable interaction in Starbright happened not in the virtual world so much as that was an enabler that brought kids together in real life, grouped around a machine. So these became very interesting parts of the experience, I think, for me as an artist working with virtual reality to understand the benefits of going away from the very high-end technology. So let's see if we can start. If we can switch over to the video and roll the first video. Not sure how many of these I have to press simultaneously. Okay, so that's one situation. So I'll show a video made by kids at one of the hospitals themselves. So you see some of the environment. Do you have the remote so I can? Is the volume controllable on this also? It's okay right now, but I'll want to.
I've been here for chemo since January. When I found out that I had cancer, it shocked me. You really couldn't do the things that you want to do. You can't socialize that much. Well, you're out of school because you're getting treatment. I used to dance, but I don't know if I'm going to go back now.
So you see the kids making videos and talking about their experience. And one thing that that wasn't immediately obvious to me but became apparent very soon is that when you say children's hospital.
In my spinal fluid. Why, the hardest part
when you say children's hospital, children range in age from 0 to 18.
What do I do?
And a lot of the older children have children of their own. I think you'll see
her
very soon. So you're, maybe it's a different sequence there.
But, because
so you're dealing with, if you've ever worked with kids, you know that the issues dealing with a 3-year-old and a 10-year-old and a 17-year-old are very different. So Starbright World had to somehow satisfy all of these different age ranges, as well as kids with very different types of medical problems. So I'll go forward a little bit here, and then, or actually, that was the sequence I wanted to show.
Get on this computer environment, or what we call Starbright World, and meet children from other hospitals. From around the nation and talking.
We're going to take you on a tour of the Starbright world.
Starbright is a computer program where kids in different hospitals can meet and play with each other.
This is the Intel ProShare video camera. And this camera lets you see other kids from different hospitals and also lets them see you.
Well, this over here is the monitor where we can see what's going on inside the Starbright worlds.
This is a hard drive. A hard drive is where all the information and memory is stored.
The microphone and earpiece help you communicate better with your friend on the other side of the computer.
Hi, this is the keyboard. Right now I am typing to someone in another room and we are communicating.
Ah, it's a mouse! Wait a minute, that's not that kind of mouse. This kind of mouse helps you move through the world and click and you can talk to your friends.
How do kids meet and, you know, do things together in the computer?
There are huge telephone lines outside that connect the hospitals that have Starbright.
Hello!
Hi!
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 Hi.
How are you?
Good.
Who are you?
Children's Hospital. Of Pittsburgh.
We're Mount Sinai, and I'm Daniel.
I'm Kara.
I'm Lauren.
And the other person just shook her head.
We can't see that fourth person.
She doesn't want to be seen.
Hello.
If someone says, no, I don't really want to be seen, I feel horrible, then they don't see each other, but they could play in the world. There's a tropical world, and that's kind of like you can hear animal noises, and you can see waterfall and a rainbow.
The audio is difficult on this tape, but
if you like to
what
get
you just
lost,
saw in that video conferencing session was that they were talking with each other face to face, as it were, and then there was one kid who was feeling really awful that day and didn't want their face to be shown. So that was another interesting thing I learned from doing this project, that you know, at some level people were saying, oh, let's just give them video conferencing and they can sit there in their beds and talk with each other. But specifically in the case of these kids who were in medically often very fragile conditions, there was a lot of value in being able to, if you were put on a mask, hide behind the mask of your avatar, still be able to go out and communicate with people, but in your virtual form and not have to show your real face. Maybe you had just lost your hair because you had just started your chemo treatments. You know, maybe you were, you know, having hoses hanging out your nose. So it was interesting having the diversity of opportunities for the kids. And then for the communication aspect, besides the video conferencing, they have the text chat, as you see. And then remember, not all kids can type very well. Kids have to learn how to type. They have to learn how to write. They also have to learn English if that's the common language being used on the system. So we had audio conferencing that made it a lot easier for kids, especially if they were feeling really awful and didn't have the energy to type. They could communicate with each other through those different methods. On the other hand, the text chat was a lot of fun for older kids who could use it as a secret code and not let the little kids in the room know what they were doing. So the diversity of means of communication, the diversity of ways to use the system turned out to be very important for Starbright. Then I have to tell you, that this piece was running, this world was running from 95 to 97. Basically, there's the old phrase of technology being ahead of its time, and that was unfortunately very true with this. The problem is that the machines were very unstable, the software was very unstable, and people at the hospital have enough troubles to deal without having machines crashing on them the whole time. Plus, something that I didn't know when I went into this was that a large proportion of the children who have these chronic diseases are from families that are below poverty level because they didn't have prenatal care, they didn't have good postnatal care, and so it's easier for a disease that's serious already to get out of hand, and there are some diseases where the poor nutrition and the poor medical care help it develop in situations that might be averted if you had the good care. So think, if you will, of trying to disperse the most expensive, newest PCs to 100 hospitals across the nation and all the homes that those kids are in, and you'll see what sort of technological troubles we had. This is the demo.
on stage, along with General Schwarzkopf and some of our support group from Starbright, will actually demonstrate, along with four of the hospitals and the children in those hospitals, where we can go and what we can do. The thing you should remember is, this is a rough cut. You all understand what that means, a rough cut? It means you really weren't supposed to be here yet, but we were so excited about this, we all invited you in to see what our work in progress. And there could be glitches, there could be some delays. I'll do what I can to facilitate you through what we're doing, but I think you'll understand very shortly how wonderful this all is. That's Lauren and I together. That's us in costume. And and actually, I'd like to get a better look at the general, so I'm going to go a little closer.
Okay.
To see what, and I think, in turn, the general is getting a closer look at us, right?
Yeah.
So let's, beautiful. You look lovely, Stephen. So,
thank you.
So
you. I like your four stars.
So that little opening in the sand dune is the passage we walk through to take us to the cave world. So why don't we head on through the cave world.
Okay.
And we'll follow the helicopter.
Okay, we're following the helicopter.
Okay. As the general heads on in, now the door opens, and the point is it requires both, you know, two kids working in concert to make something happen. So this is a very simple example of a cooperative activity for the kids.
We will soon be giving all the avatars on the screen, all the characters, a number of powers. So, I'm just in the clouds over this right now. I'm just with you in the clouds, trying to trying to figure out who drew you.
And who are you?
With a green car.
Well, I know that. Well, let me ask you, where are you, car?
We're upstairs in the fifth floor.
Aha, uh-huh. So I think I know that. We know who this is, don't we, Dan?
Yeah.
Yeah. We won't reveal your name. What do you like to do, car?
We want a drag race.
So here we are now, down in the down in the building zone, and I suspect our friend the fish is joining us.
Yep, there's a fish.
There he is.
Oh.
So, let's see. Now, one of the important things about the building zone, this is fundamentally different from the other three zones you've seen in Starbright World so far. The neat thing about the building zone is that the kids can design and build it themselves. They can make additions to this world that allow the world to grow, and those changes stick around so the next kid who comes in can see them and they can share that environment. Why don't we quickly swing over and see what's happening with the general and the green car.
Okay.
So if we can change perspectives, that's great.
This is waiting a long time. You see, the general's pacing.
Who's going to give us the command to go? That's what I want to know now.
I will.
Yeah, no, no way.
No.
Let's watch. We can watch from right here. That's great. Watch the race.
Stephen,
right.
Do you want to give
me...
Oh, wait a minute. I want an impartial judge doing this. Stephen, you want to give us a command to go?
Okay. On your marks. Get set.
Go. Come on, Danny. Come on, Danny. Come on, Danny. Go, Danny. Don't let that car beat us. Come on, Danny. Go. Come on, Danny. We're lagging behind, Danny. Come on, Danny.
Okay.
All right. Great.
Okay, let's see. So there were a lot of activities that you could do in the world. There was, a second racetrack built. Some people were building gardens. But basically, as I was saying before I started showing that tape, the technology just became too problematic. And what they did in 1997 then was that they took this world down and basically replaced it with a 2D multimedia website. So they're doing a lot of, they're also doing like CD-ROMs, they're doing a lot of a sort of educational, edutainment, there we go. The education entertainment projects that really help a kid to understand and learn how to cope with their illnesses. But unfortunately, the 3D online MUD was just too technologically difficult to implement. It'd be easier now, but again, the process of deploying it across not only the 100 hospitals that they want to have on the network, but getting connections to everyone's homes and getting computers into everyone's homes. And another little detail that one of the doctors at Mount Sinai Hospital told me at that point, that was 1995, was that, for instance, in Harlem, there hadn't been any new telephone wires installed since 1975. So, you know, we're talking about the infrastructure of America as a country, and that's a pretty big thing for any foundation to try and take on. And it's sad. That's reality. And this was a very heavy reality dose. The other little detail that was very difficult for me to deal with was that I had to accept that there were plenty of people. This was a multi-million dollar project. It was getting multi-million dollars worth of donations. And you couldn't get those same people to divert the money into providing better health care for the kids. They wanted to, you know, they had a place where they wanted to see their money being used, and also, of course, obviously, you know, the computer donations, the in-kind donations, you can't just turn them into money. So the reality is that you have to kind of take what people are willing to give, and they're more willing to give things for flashy high-tech projects than for basic healthcare. So that was tough. But reality, now we have to figure out how to get the computer back up. It was one of these buttons.
Have you more recently taught it as a class or taught related
projects? The technology or? But yeah, actually what I'm doing right now at UCSD for this one quarter is actually based more on the technology that I use in the next project, Beyond Manzanar, which we will throw up on the screen since you just happened to ask. Where's the back button? Oh, it's actually easier here. The Starbright World project was built using a proprietary Worlds Incorporated technology, and when Worlds went down in 1997, I think, the technology went down with them. Active Worlds was part of the platform. You probably know that's been continued in the Active Worlds spaces online. But the open standard that was coming up was VRML, VRML, and that's the one that I ended up using to do my next project. And that's what I was teaching actually down at UCSD. The students were using 3D Studio Max to build the geometry, and then we're exporting it into VRML, and then adding the interactivity largely by hand in VRML, although you can actually put in a lot of those triggers now within 3D Max itself. So similar technology, basically the same sort of effect. The big difference for me, working with Beyond Manzanar, I started this project in 1995. And let me give you some of the background of that. Let's see if I have it already up. Yeah. 1995 was the year of the worst terrorist attack in American history, Oklahoma City bombing. And maybe you remember that within the first, I think, two or three days of the bombing, it was assumed that that attack was also from Middle Eastern terrorists, as they're called. And my friend Zara Hushman, who's Iranian-American, said that, you know, in her community, people were being attacked on the streets. The same sort of attacking that happens after every active war attack was happening then. And Zara was in the situation where she had booked a meditation retreat in the High Sierras, and it happened to be that she had to leave the day after Oklahoma City. So there she was in the High Sierras, spending a week not talking and not thinking, and in the back of her mind, despite all of her efforts, was the idea, when I go back to San Francisco, if Iran's behind this attack, I and other Iranian-Americans might be interned. So she knew that the Manzanar internment camp was very close to where she was, and went and visited after the attack. This is a photograph of the Manzanar internment camp from 1943. It was done by Ansel Adams. And I think a lot of people indicated that they knew of the internment, but I'll summarize it very briefly, that basically after the bombing of, after Japan bombed Pearl Harbor, about, what was that, 5 months later, 3 months later, the U.S. military, which was in charge of the entire west coast of the United States, said that they had secret evidence that showed that there was a military necessity to intern every man, woman, and child down to 1/16th Japanese blood. Otherwise, there was going to be sabotage. And it turns out in the 1980s, under the Freedom of Information Act, they were able to force out that information and it turned out that actually the FBI's studies, the Army's own studies, all of the intelligence agencies' studies said there was no danger of sabotage from the Japanese American community. And if there was any danger, it would have come from the people who the FBI had rounded up the night of Pearl Harbor anyway. So what actually happened in the internment, and this is a point that doesn't really hit the papers even now when people are making comparison, was that the internment happened not because of military necessity, but because General DeWitt, who is in charge of the West Coast, covered up the evidence to the contrary and claimed military necessity in order to put the Japanese Americans in the camp. So, Zara was here at Manzanar. It's a high desert at the base of the Sierra Nevada. And from her, from the descriptions she had read, she had expected a desert hellhole. And that's, of course, how it had appeared to the Japanese Americans, who are used to a much more humid climate and a much more moderate climate. But to Zara's eyes, the site of Manzanar looks like home. It looks like paradise. It looks like Iran, which also, in this photograph of a village near Kerman, you see the same sort of high desert, the same high mountains, and the snow melt that enables people to build in little oases formed at the base of the mountains. And when she came back to San Francisco, where we were both working at Worlds Incorporated at the time, she told me about how even the grid of the camp, and here you see the Manzanar internment camp, the barracks are now gone, but the grid still remains, the desert scrub. And to her Iranian eyes, even that, although it looks to us like a military camp, reminded her of Persian paradise gardens that had been abandoned by their human inhabitants and had been taken back by the desert. She told me that the word pardis, from which we draw our word for paradise, means a walled orchard. And that, in fact, this geometric structure of the orchards comes from the concept of paradise as being an expression of geometric perfection, that geometry expresses the perfection of paradise. And her talk of paradise gardens in the middle of internment camps reminded me that I'd heard as a child that there actually had been ones built. And I was able to find this image, another Ansel Adams photograph, of the most extensive of the gardens built in Manzanar. And this is actually also built in the form of a Japanese paradise garden, with a rock in the form of a turtle to symbolize longevity, so that you know this is where the immortals come. Bridges between ponds and islands. Here you see a very rustic tea structure. And we talked more and more over the years about this strange confluence of internment camps and paradise gardens and these very emotional reactions that the same site of Manzanar evoked in both my ethnic group and her ethnic group. And at some point, we decided it had to be an art project. And then I, being stubborn as I am, decided it had to be a virtual reality art project because I'd been looking for an idea that would really express itself well in VR, that would really use the characteristics of VR well. And there was a book that I read called Farewell to Manzanar, where the woman describes being a child sitting in exactly this garden and trying very hard to be very still and not to move, because as soon as she moved, she would not see the garden anymore. She would see the garden framed by the barracks and the guard towers. She would fall out of the garden if she moved too much. And that, to me, was something that virtual reality, the spatial experience centered around movement was something that I thought virtual reality could do in a way that no other medium really could. So with that, let me start this and warn you that this machine crashed in a very interesting manner when we were trying it out, so it might happen again. This is the landscape of Manzanar. You see the high mountains, and you might hear the azan, the Islamic call to prayer, which we put in to add an Iranian feeling to the landscape. Before we fade you back into the internment camp. I didn't want to put avatars in the space, I didn't want to put little plastic people, but I wanted to put in voices from the past and speaking in a very interesting way, to put in public voices and very private voices. And we did that with poetry from Rumi, poetry from the Manyoshu, classical Japanese, their English translations, and then also poetry from a man who was in one of the other internment camps, who stood at a fence very like this one and might have had these thoughts. I show this piece as an installation on a life-size screen so that you really get the feeling for the scale. But I actually made the scale a little bit larger than real life because most of the Japanese were smaller than we are. My grandparents were they were about 4'8" or so. So to give a proportion that was more that experienced by the Japanese American immigrants themselves, rather than their American-born children, the fence is a bit bigger and the barracks are a bit bigger. The writing in the sky fades in slowly and then fades out slowly. So it's not always there. You don't always think about the fact that you've been interned. You don't always think about the danger that awaits you if you would go out. But it always comes back. Yeah, you shut the door behind you too. So you can't get it back out and you have to look for another way. You probably know how hard it is to get people to follow a path in VR, so that's a very useful device. So you can escape from the camp into a fantasy. This is the same landscape. You're in the same place, but look how different it looks when it's framed by a paradise garden. It's a Japanese garden technique called captured scenery, where you use existing scenery around the garden and build it into the landscape of your garden so it becomes the background. I thought the term was very appropriate for this garden. The mountains are my captured scenery. If you move too far into the garden, you fall out again. This whole sequence we call the American Dream. photographs from pre-war Japanese American life. Here, different sources, there's actually a fair number of family photographs, although none of my family was actually in Manzanar. My great-grandparents were in Topaz, but it was easier to exploit my own family to get photographs than to get them. I was in Germany working on this at the time. The woman you hear singing is Mary Nomura, the songbird of Manzanar. And these are the parents of another friend I made who were actually in Manzanar also, and whose photographs you see in the next space also. So this is also the American dream, but now in times of war. And people like Mary were holding concerts in the camps, trying to keep people's spirits up. After an evacuation which took people away from their homes. So here, you can look back into the past, but I don't let you go there. You have the memories, but you can't regain it. So life went on in Manzanar. This was an American history class. But you always had the reality of the camp out there. And this shows the true extent of the camp. The barracks going off to both sides. So in the research for this project, we found out that the Japanese American Senator Hayakawa actually had introduced a bill during the Iranian hostage crisis, 1979, to intern all Iranians living in America. We didn't know that when we started out. We were doing the piece based on Zara's subjective feeling of danger. And as we went along, people, Japanese Americans I talked to, mentioned that they seemed to remember that this happened. So it was very hard to find information on that. It's kind of faded out of memory. So all of these headlines, you might have heard similar ones very recently, but these are all from the 1979 hostage crisis. This is the Iranian American dream. I don't see a yellow river around the old oak tree. And if you look too closely at the photographs, the walls turn transparent and you see images of the hostage crisis and revolution and of the Manzanar internment camp. Hovering below is a symbolic fear of internment. Now I've got to know what is. If you receive my letter telling you I'd soon be free, then you'll know just what to do if you still want me. The way out of that confusion is into the Iranian paradise garden. When we show this to Iranians, they say, oh, did you rebuild Shiraz or so? But this, again, is Manzanar, but framed, again, in a very different way. When you try and exit the garden, you start the war. You probably know that virtual reality was developed for flight simulators, because if you crash an F-15, it's really expensive. And of course, it's the most common use of this sort of 3D technology right now is in games and in flight simulators, such as the one from Microsoft, where you could crash into the World Trade Center Volunteers. Margaret! You want to drive? Okay. Someone else has to drive it. Come on. One of you guys. just a second. The easiest thing is to use the arrow keys right there. I would guess at some point, I mean, certainly there have been online communities since 1994 and 1995, the Active Worlds one, the Cybertown one that was being run by Black Sun. There are issues, though, for instance, the issue of motion sickness, and that a lot of kids couldn't take a whole lot of motion. But of course, the biggest issue is the financial access. And it still sort of depends on what level of space you have. The Beyond Manzanar project needs a fairly fast PC to run. It doesn't run on the Mac because the browser I use doesn't run on the Mac. So I think at the point where everyone has 3D spaces running on their computers and that's how they come from the shop, yeah, I suspect it'll start happening. It'll be very interesting to see what happens when they can sort of grow of their own accord. But again, it'll be a class society. Yeah. No, it's really too big. It's too big, and the real difficult thing is the triggers. I mean. A lot of the timing is delicate enough so that if I run it on the laptop and the projector aren't very happy with each other, then, for instance, the trigger that takes you up in the sky when the video war starts, that sometimes doesn't work, which is really embarrassing in public lectures. So I don't run it off the internet. In the U.S. or... The U.S. has been sort of restricted. I live over in Germany, so it's a little bit hard for me to show over here. I've shown it at the Cherry Blossom Festival in Seattle, and there a large number of the Manzanar inhabitants came from Bainbridge Island outside of Seattle. So that was the first chance where I got a lot of feedback from the Japanese-American community, and specifically internees. And they were, that was extremely rewarding, and one of my favorite memories is of seeing this little old lady. Remember that the people born in the camps are over 55, so the internees are all pretty old, and you know, at some point seeing this little old lady sort of jumped up and like grabbed the joystick so that no one else would get it because she finally wanted to have her turn, and that's not a reaction you see a lot from little old ladies, so that was really gratifying. And then a couple other internees told me that you know, the kids like it because they think it's a game. And then they say, Grandma, how come all of these barbed wire fences are here? Well, let me tell you. And a couple of internees really told me that in the course of viewing my piece, they had the first opportunity to really have a dialogue with their grandkids about being interned because the kids had no concept of what it means and they're not interested in those old photographs. So I found it very interesting as a way to bring that subject matter to a younger generation and also enable communications between the older generations who experienced it or can understand conceptually what it's about and the kids who can show them how your grandma, let me show you how you do this, you know. So that was very gratifying. And otherwise, in the States, SIGGRAPH, the Computer Graphics Festival, And that was also interesting because I had expected a lot of people to come in. I mean, that's, you know, the latest and the greatest in computer graphics. And I expected it to have a very lukewarm reception from the high-end people, but there were a lot of people saying, oh my God, I didn't think you could do this sort of content, this depth of content in the medium. So that was gratifying also. Otherwise, I'm giving a talk to curators at the Japanese American National Museum on Friday, but otherwise there doesn't seem to be much interest, frankly. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And that's obviously a very good venue, but I get the feeling that I think they're a little bit nervous about they're a little bit nervous about the Iranian-American content because in the current situation that might be difficult. But we'll find out. I'll let you know. Hopefully they'll show it, but hopefully, I don't know. Art museums don't seem to be interested, and it's been a bit frustrating, but maybe. I talked to a curator at MoCA. I had shown her a working version, but she wasn't interested in seeing the final version. If you can think of any people who might be interested, I'd be happy to talk with them. Yeah. Pardon? Yeah. I wrote. It's not very romantic. I wrote an email saying I will be in the States and I could show you the finished version. Would you be interested in seeing it? And the answer was, I do not have time to meet with you. So, you know, they don't. You know. Yeah. 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 Wow. Yeah. All right. I think I'll have to start one of those too. Yeah, I think the Germans are really happy to say, oh, you mean it's not about our internment camps? the Japanese, I don't know why it's called the Japanese internment and the Nazi Holocaust. It's like, how come it's not the American internment camps? Yeah, it's like parody here. But anyway, you know, I've shown it in Japan a couple of times at new media festivals. It's actually, thanks to Kathy Ray Huffman, who some of you might know, in the Web 3D art show, it's being shown in the ICA in London for the next month or so. Ah, next victim. Yeah, I've had some. I can't complain. I really can't complain. It's just, I had some romantic notion that since it was so topical, since it really expressed the political situation at the time, people would want to show it, but that was wrong. Yeah. And I think there's also a fear of being seen critical of the government right now.
Yeah, this is strange.
Yeah.
Well, that's a good one, actually.
Yeah.
And then there's the other side, too, where political statements in the arts are not fashionable.
Right.
So oops, whoa. That was a reason to turn the art museums against
yeah.
They don't want to deal with politics.
Yeah. Right, yeah. Right, yeah. Oh, really? I saw, Oh, yeah, that would be interesting. Especially if we could go in winter. Get on Jeremy. What? Well, that's not quite true. Shall I show you my credits page? The predominant amount of building was done by me. Zara was designing the Iranian sections and feeding me materials, but she doesn't build. So in terms of building, I did a lot of it, and then, 90% of it. And then I was able to get a residency at the Yamas Media Arts School in Japan. And there was a guy there who does sound who did a lot of the sound effects for me and taught me how to do the rest for myself. And then when we're floating down from the sky, and the poem is on the background of the sky, there's a voice reciting, it probably sounds Japanese to you, he's actually speaking in English. It's a Shinto priest who wants to be the first cyber priest, the cyber Shinto priest. And he was he was feeding us a lot of cultural information and talking about how if we show the piece is a memorial. So each time we show the piece, it is as if we are reciting a prayer for the people who died at Manzanar or who died in the camps. And we'd asked him if he would do a Norito, a Japanese Shinto prayer. And he said, actually, what I'd like to do is do an English version of your mandala for Manzanar, the end poem. And every time my voice, and if I do it in the form of a Japanese norito, the gods will hear it, even though it's in English, and they will respond to it. So every time the piece is shown, every time we cycle through, the gods are like, oh, okay, getting the message again. So in his view, which is not maybe a traditional Shinto view, but fitting in with the animism concept and the concept of Tibetan prayer wheels or so, fits in very well that when the mechanical device of the computer repeats this prayer, the gods hear it just as they would as if a human would. So that was a very interesting cultural assist that we got.
Does it take a great deal of, apart from the time, do you actually have to pay a fair amount of money to, what is the cost involved in interesting in doing this?
Yeah, the cost is primarily time. I mean, I had a PC of my own at home, which was about a $3,000 machine, but it was really mostly that my time spent building, and most of that I funded out of our savings. And, you know, this big chunk was funded by Yamas, where I had 5 months where I was being paid to build it, so that was really terrific. In terms of actual time, I figure I spent a year and a half working full time on it. But that was spread out over 3 years. And that includes research and building and lots of rebuilding when it wasn't working.
Any other questions?
We're right at time, Annie. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much.
Well, thank you.
Besides trying to push the technology and the aesthetics, are trying to be meaningful too.
Uh-huh.
And really do something, give some kind of information.
Uh-huh. Thanks.
Thank you.